Good evening. Rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening to the April 7th, 2014 Selectmen's Meeting. First agenda item is the presentation of the Patriot Award by Mr. Follinsby of the Employee Support of the Garden Reserve. Sir, please, floor is yours.
Chairman Bean.
Mr. Follinsby, if you use the microphone.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You want everybody at home to hear you as well.
Chairman Bean, Town Manager Welch, Chief Sullivan, friends of Officer Reno's family, members of the town of Hampton, thank you very much for allowing me to be here tonight and make this presentation. Employer support of the Garden Reserve, ESGR is what I'll refer to it as. Our mission is to enhance and maintain relationships between employers and the reservists and the reserve component members. And I am very pleased to have with me tonight the State ESGR Executive Director, Jim Goss, who will be helping with the presentation. Part of our job, part of the way that we enhance and maintain the relationship, is through recognition of employers, like the town of Hampton, and specifically the Hampton Police Department. Officer Reno has nominated Chief Sullivan and his command staff to receive the ESGR Patriotic Employer Awards, and that's why we're here tonight. The first award that we'd like to present, let me bring Officer Reno, would you come forward? The first presentation will be to Chief James Sullivan. The second one is to Deputy Chief Richard Sawyer. The third award is to Lieutenant Dan Gadaitis. Gadaitis?
Thomas.
Thomas.
There we go. Good job. Thank you, Alex.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Lieutenant Tom Kindley. Thank you. Detective Sergeant Stephen Chapman. Thank you very much. Thank you for allowing us to come in and make this presentation.
Thank you very much, sir. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much, and thank you so much for all the support that you and your officers have provided.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, it's our pleasure.
Thank you.
Are you ready for promotion?
Thank you very much.
In one move up, we are going to do a promotion. The Chief of the Hampton Police Department, Jamie Sullivan. Sir.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen of the board. It's our pleasure tonight to offer for promotion of Detective Reno to the rank of sergeant, having nothing to do with his sucking-upping, awarding, having solely to do with his performance and his leadership abilities. So we would ask our town clerk to come forward to perform the swearing-in of Detective Reno.
From the town of Hampton, the county of Rockingham, to Alexander J. Reno of North Hampton, New Hampshire, in the county of Rockingham. Whereas there is a vacancy in the office of police sergeant in said town, and whereas we, the subscribers, have confidence in your ability and integrity to perform the duties of said office, we do hereby appoint you the said Alexander J. Reno as police sergeant of said town. And upon your taking the oath of office, and having this appointment and the certificate of said oath of office recorded by the town clerk, you shall have the powers, perform the duties, and be subject to the liabilities of such office until another person shall be chosen and qualified in your stead. Given under my hand this 7th day of April 2014, Fred Welch. Town Manager. Raise your right hand. Repeat after me. I, Alexander J. Reno.
I, Alexander J. Reno.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
Discharge and perform.
Discharge and perform.
All the duties incumbent on me.
All the duties incumbent on me.
As Police Sergeant.
As Police Sergeant.
According to the best of my abilities.
According to the best of my abilities.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Of this Constitution.
Of this Constitution.
And the laws of the State of New Hampshire.
And the laws of the State of New Hampshire.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
No blood.
First, I want to thank, obviously, Chief Sullivan, Deputy Chief Sawyer, Town Manager Welch for having the faith in me to be able to fill this vacancy. First, the biggest supporter that I have, my wife, Kimberly. This is huge for us and for our family as we're expecting a child in October. This is going to be good for us as well, and the support of my family. And I believe that any promotion is not possible if it wasn't for the people that you work with. And we happen to have a fantastic department full of skilled and dedicated officers for this town. Very proud to serve with them, and I appreciate everything they've done to help me get to where I am today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That's all we have this evening.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you so much.
Good support for you. Oh, yeah. It's a good thing.
The security issues need to be taken care of. They need to be made whole.
And on behalf of the board, congratulations to the new sergeant in the Hampton Police Department. That was a wonderful ceremony. Moving on, the public comment period. Those that wish to take the podium and speak publicly, please. Mr. Moody, sir. Yes, sir.
Art Moody, 3 Thompson Road. Pardon moi. I heard the manager last week about the Senate bill that's going to allow cemetery sales of plots to go immediately into the cemetery burial trust fund in order to immediately make money on that instead of waiting until it's the end of the year and appropriating a total amount for the previous year. Last year, of course, there was zero put in there because Selectman Bohr thought it was too small, so they put it in the general fund. And yet, this year, you did it again. You did it, and it was the same amount as last year, or nearly. And then I read the library trustees' meetings and find out that that apparently the board, some private meeting, allowed the town council to represent the library trustees to go to probate court to change the terms of a bequest to the library trustees. Apparently they didn't want to handle the trust fund, $3,800, and they wanted the trustees of trust funds to handle it instead. So the town is paying $500 filing fee for that $3,800 to be transferred to the trustees of trust funds, which in that common fund made 3.4% last year. So it'll take 3.5 years just to make up that $500 fee, which that income will go to the library trustees. So I decided to look at the trustees of trust fund report in the town report for last year, looking at the charts first, because I'm familiar with the MS-9 state form, and I was surprised at all the minuses in the principal amounts in trust funds and capital reserve funds, and they apparently lost tens of thousands of dollars in value, except for the real estate trust fund, which was very successful. Then I read the chairman's report, 2.5 pages, and wasn't a word about all those losses. And I started looking deeper and found out that they, the only fee that they mentioned is $18,000 to Mackeson and Company. But the report is that it comes out of the portfolio. You can't base fees for assistance in managing the trust funds based on the portfolio. It has to be based on income earned according to the direction of the Director of Charitable Trust in the Attorney General's office. So then I got to wondering, what about the fees for these two common funds and the real estate trust fund that is out in Kansas? There's no mention of those fees, but there had to be funds for those common funds and the real estate trust funds. They're unreported. They have to be reported. They have to come clean and say how much is being spent out of public funds for the assistance in managing our trust funds and capital reserve funds. Actually, there's 4 clients, 2 school districts, village district in the town, and 3 of those clients did very badly last year in their investment policy. In fact, I'm sure that Winneconnet High School is sad that they even chose Hampton instead of the other 3 towns' trust funds to put their expendable trust funds in. They put $190,000 early in their fiscal year last year, and by the end of the year, in December of our fiscal year, 3 months later, it lost $20,000 from those 3 expendable trust funds. Hampton School District, $5,000 lost. What's coming off? All goes back to 2007, when the expanded board to 5 members of the trust funds decided they were going into the stock market. And that's the basis of good years and bad years. Last year was a bad year for those three clients. And is it any wonder that the Village District recently voted to do away with one of their capital reserve funds and drew down a second one. They have three. Selectmen designated $142,000 to the expendable leave trust fund last August from surplus. By the end of the year, it lost $3,500. So I think there should be the word invest should be changed to investigation. And I think that selectmen should find out why the MS-9 form has been modified, where it says income from each of the, during the year, from each of the accounts. It says net income. The state form says income, the last I knew. And I did those forms for 30 years. I think you ought to find out the full amount of the fees. And I think you should find out if Mackeson and Company has some kind of an interest financially in that company in Kansas. And I also think that you should find out why the poor performance of the two school district expendable trust funds, four in number, weren't reported at the end of the year to the school districts, because they're required to be published in their annual report, the condition of those expendable and non-expendable trust funds that they create. That's school law. And I also should find out why they're taking fees, $18,600 Mackeson Company, for bookkeeping, I guess, from the portfolio. Hampton, just the Hampton portfolio. But it cannot be based on that. It has to be based on income earned per the Attorney General's office. And I believe that five members of that board, they only meet quarterly. I'm wondering if they found out they're poorly, some of the poor accounts, whereas the real estate trust fund did great. Whether five members are necessary, and whether in their quarterly meeting in January they changed their investment policy. Each of the school districts have to have an investment policy, but it doesn't affect the town's trustees of trust funds. And I'm sure if Winnicott had chosen Seabrook, Hampton Falls, or Northampton trustees of trust funds, there would have been a much more conservative investment. But when they, Winnicott had started their spendable trust funds back in 2007, they never asked the Hampton trustees in advance whether they would be willing to do it. They just put Hampton in their Warren article. So maybe they deserve what they get. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Further public comment?
Corrine Baker, 244 Exeter Road. I'm chairman of the Recycling Committee. And last week I spoke here in hopes of getting us put on the agenda this week, because we had been sunsetted, and I wanted to make a presentation. But I see that we're on the old business rather than on under appointments, and I wanted to get some assurance that there will be some dialogue between committee members and the Board of Selectmen during that old business time, and I don't know if that's normal or if you can do it or not. But if not, then we're going to have to do a public comment again like we did last week, and hope that we just sit and listen to the rest of it. So can I get some assurance?
What would you like for assurance, Corrine, and how many speakers?
There are three of us here that have very short comments. I do not have my long thing.
Given,
it's just points.
Fact that, if I may.
Yeah.
And given the fact that we spoke and listened about 20 minutes last week, we weren't prepared to make a decision last week. We've been provided research from town staff. Why don't we just bring you three members up? I think we understand your point of view, but we'll bring you folks up under old business. You can sit and relax and enjoy the meeting.
Okay. And will we be able to ask questions of the selectmen?
I don't know if that's going to be appropriate, but I would like you to all three come up and sit, and if the board members would like to discuss it with you. But we spoke for 20 minutes on it. We've done the research. I think the board, those members that are prepared to make a motion, can do so. But we'll invite you up to the table under old business when the
issue comes.
Is that good?
If there's not going to be interaction, then we might as well speak at public comment.
Okay. Does the board have a pleasure on this? It is a board of perhaps former standing, minimal standing right now. It is not officially sunset yet. Does the board have a pleasure?
I think it's more appropriate to come in under public comment now.
Does the board have any dissenting opinion from Selectman Woolsey? Okay. So please, Corinne, the board's pleasure is to have the floor again. Thank you.
We were at the tag sale on and. Event on Saturday, and we interacted with a lot of people there. A lot of questions, and it's amazing. There were not just Hampton people, there were people from all over the place, and you know, they wanted us to go and speak with their town officials about what we're doing in Hampton, because they see the green bins every place. They think it's fabulous that Hampton is recycling. They think it's fabulous that we're able to do it from I mean, I'm not out of 100 people say it, but the comments were that Hampton is a leader in the recycling movement, and that we as the committee are champions of this movement, and every cause needs a champion. So I honestly think that people are recycling. I came down from Exeter Road tonight. I passed two houses that had overflowed bins, and I would be happy to leave them one of those letters that I gave you copies of last week, just to give them information, because that's the biggest problem. They don't know exactly what they can recycle and what they can't recycle. I think that the list of boards and committees of a town, as we see on our website, gives the values of the community. And when you look at this list, you see what Hampton values. They think the cable TV is important. Highway safety is important. Library trustees are important. Planning board, and they think the Recycling Education Committee is important. That's the values of our town, and I'm proud to say that I am a resident here. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Further comment, please?
Good evening, Tammy DeLand, 12 Bourne Ave. I understand that you've done your research, so you've probably already made your decision, but I just wanted to let you know the outcome of Saturday was pretty good, as Corinne was telling you. We had a lot of people that weren't sure what to recycle and what they can't recycle, so we were passing out EcoMain pamphlets, which was this little pamphlet, and we were including a magnet with it. Lisa had a very good point, and she said for every program to be successful, you need to have champions on your team. Programs don't just survive on their own. She made a lot of sense by comparing it to a garden. A garden needs nurturing, water, and sunshine, and the recycling committee are the water and the food. So we're all proud to be living in this community, so the more we recycle, the more money we will save on tipping fees for waste disposal. I'm sure you already know all that. So that's all I want to say.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, Tony Trosser, 39 Mill Road. And we've arranged with Brian to kind of just show some slides of Saturday's event. So, Brian, if you could put them up on the TV, we'd appreciate it. Okay. You know, we had Celestina there, who The kids all just got such a kick out of her and were just enthralled with her. And lots of people came up to our table, had all kinds of questions. Do we have to clean all our cans? Can we recycle the lids? A lady from Northampton said, gee, I wish they'd give us a list of things we can and can't recycle. And, you know, this is something our committee does. The world of recycling keeps changing in terms of what's marketable and so on, and it is our goal just to simply get out that information to people to continue to educate them and motivate them. And I've been on the committee for 5 years, so I'm kind of the longest person here on this committee. And I just want to say that basically our goal is simply to educate, that we just want to help continue to motivate people. It's just not an issue that just goes away. So, board wants to continue to encourage people to recycle, then I guess I don't see any reason why you would sunset our committee. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Further public comment this evening? Sir.
Bob Preston. I heard tonight that the selectmen want to talk about trash again. And I think we've talked about trash plenty enough, but I heard it has come back. So I wanted to say just a couple things about this. The last election, I remember hearing that once and for all, we're going to take care of this trash issue. And we put it on the ballot, and a few people went out and campaigned, and I did campaign. I talked to a lot of business people. I talked to condo people. I talked to residents throughout the town. Most of my campaigning was uptown because that's where the voters are. The voters don't want to change anything. They want to keep things the way they are. They think that the Department of Public Works is doing an excellent job, you know, particularly at the beach in the summertime, but they do a good job throughout the town. So we had a vote, and the vote was over 2,500 to 465 votes. I mean, if that is not a repudiation of the idea that we should change trash, I don't know that we can get one. So I think we should just say, look, we talked about it, the voters talked about it. This is the way to handle trash from now on. Now, we may hear that vote that we took was not what we're going to talk about tonight. Tonight we're going to talk about picking up less days. Let's cut back on the trash. Why not just pick up the bare minimum and see what that does to our beach? They do a terrible thing to the beach. I think the voters understand when they voted 2,500 to 465 that they want to keep the town's tax base as it is. They want it to continue to grow. They want the beach to be better. This is a community where we all work together. We all help one another. We put each other's children through schools. That's what Hampton does. I think it'd be a shame to go change the policy. I think the people voted on it. I think we ought to keep the trash the way it is. I just don't understand why we want to keep wasting our time on it. We're going down the road. Hampton's got a lot of good things going. Let's just keep going, working at it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bob, I just wanted to ask you something. You might know the answer to this. You know the meeting that they're supposed to have down there at the Shell to introduce that Brian Wilson? It's a Saturday morning, I believe.
Yeah.
Do you know the date?
No, but I'll get it to you.
Okay, right. Thank you.
Any further public comment?
Bob Ladd, 7 Cutler Avenue, and I'm speaking in two capacities tonight. One as a representative of the Village District, and the other as an owner of property on a private way. The purpose of my conversation is to encourage the sunsetting of this trash issue. It's been going on for years. Last year alone, it was brought up at the August 12th meeting, the August 19th meeting. We spoke to it at the December 17th meeting. It was brought up at the deliberate session, and it was voted upon. the idea that all private ways, although they have been having this collection service for 50, 60, 70 years, since the beginning of the DPW's collecting trash, should not now get that service just seems totally inequitable. None of us signed condominium documents. We don't have condo fees, which would have been explained to us as to what those fees covered in terms of services. And any condo fee would obviously say part of your fee is to dispose of trash in the condominium, if that were the case. The assessed value of these private ways is well in excess of $100 million, a very significant contribution to the tax revenue stream of the town. Many of these roads are at the beach. Many of them could not be brought up to standard because you'd have to take the houses down to rebuild the roads. And I don't anticipate that's likely to happen unless nature were to cause it. Further, the argument has been raised that the town assumes great liability by going on a private way. In reality, liability only occurs when the town does something in a negligent way. Not being on a private way doesn't create liability. Negligence creates liability. And I would suggest every time a truck leaves the DPW yard and picks up trash on a public way, it's exposed to liability. And it is far more of its time is concentrated on the public way than the private way. Further, this is a very divisive issue, and it just continues to cause a maelstrom of discontent in the community. And as Mr. Preston suggested, we've had a total plebiscite on this issue, a vote that probably no other article has been so overwhelmingly supported on one side of an issue. Many of the homes in the private ways are multifamily properties. At the deliberative session, it was brought out that these properties would not have trash collection if this article passed. There are two-family condominiums on these roads. These issues have been addressed over and over again. And I would suggest that you consider going back and revisiting your August 19th meeting. At that time, this issue was thoroughly vetted. And toward the end of that meeting, Chairman Nichols said, I am not in favor of changing the way we do business. And the board then elected to continue it as it was. You also should consider that if this were to happen, you're impacting so many people that a class action against the town is not inconceivable. If a class action were to happen, and certainly none of us want that, the town perhaps would then be required in discovery to prove the legitimacy of all the public ways. I'm not sure the town has the sorts of records available to prove that, which would further muddy it up. And there could also be in that class action an asking that the town assess private way properties different than public way properties, which it does not do. Nobody on a private way gets a tax abatement, even though the services are much less than those on the public way. So we have all these things to consider, and in the tax arena, the argument of a valorem tax. We don't tax by service, but you do tax by appraised value. And if you take away all the services, you could impair the appraised value of these properties, meaning they'd be worth less. So there's a lot to be considered here. It's been considered over and over. It consumes the board's time when it should be more properly addressed going forward. We could revisit this forever, but it seems to me this is a perfect time to end the discussion. The town has spoken. It's spoken massively in favor of services. And when we all come to the end of our life on this earth, we will be judged more by what we do for each other than what we do to each other. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Any further public comment this evening?
Can I just answer?
Round two. Yes, ma'am.
I don't know that gentleman's name.
That's Mr. Ladd.
It seems that the Recycle Committee is kind of being blamed for instigating change as far as who gets picked up and who doesn't get picked up, whose trash gets picked up and whose trash doesn't get picked up, and also as on the pay-as-you-throw. The committee is volunteers. We are not elected, and we do not make policy. All we do is recycling education. We teach people what can be recycled. We teach them how to recycle. We have nothing to do with private way, public way, double condominium, two-family houses. This is strictly the selectmen and the Department of Public Works decisions. And he's right. It seems like every week you better check to see if your trash is going to be picked up next week because it could change. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Further public comment, Mr. Rage.
I seem to be talking a lot of trash lately, and I don't like to do that. There's not much to add to what the two Bobs had said, but I know that the town has spoken. Everybody I've talked to want to keep everything the same. The vote was, I think, 83% or 84% to keep things the same, and I hope the selectmen will work with the whole town, not just part of the town. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Further public comment this evening? Okay, and this is the last on trash,
yeah.
and the last from recycling.
I just want to, Tony Trotzer, 39 Mill Road. I just want to separate us from this whole trash issue, as Corinne said. And at one point, we appeared before the board to talk about pay-as-you-throw, and the only reason we were there was because we were asked by the DPW director, who was also asked to research pay-as-you-throw. So he just did a presentation, asked us to research it, and we came to the board and just talked about it. We had nothing to do with trying to push for any kind of policies, and that's why when I said I've been on this committee for 5 years, we have not in any way tried to influence or, you know, deal with policy. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Further public comment this evening? Seeing none. Roman Free, announcements and community calendar. Selectman Waddell.
Nothing.
Nothing.
Thank you. On April 26th, Saturday, between 10 and 12, Mike Hossman from DRED is going to have a event where people are going to be able to talk and suggest things, and they're also going to introduce Brian Wilson, who's the new person that's, what is the title of that, Mr. Welch?
CECO Supervisor.
The CECO Supervisor. So people will have a chance to meet him. He is somebody that's been working in towns nearby in the recreation department, so he has a lot of experience working with people, and they're looking forward to having him start for this year. So that's at April 26th, Saturday, 10 to 12, at the hotel down at the beach. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Roman IV appointments, Sean McWilliam, the American Lung Association.
Here?
Yes, sir, please.
All right. Very good. All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for letting me come and speak with you tonight. We're really excited about this year's event. It's our fifth annual Cycle the Seacoast event. I want to thank you all for your past support of this event. Just to kind of give you an overview, the ride this year is May 4th, Sunday, May 4th. And noticed I said ride. It is a at-your-own-pace ride. It is not a race. We like to make sure people know that as we're educating them about the event. We have 25, 50, and 100-mile route options. It was when we started this ride, a few of the towns had recommended, and I believe this town was one of them, that we do what we can to spread out our participants. And so what we continue to do is the three routes leave once an hour, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, and 9 o'clock. And so that helps kind of spread everybody out, which is good for, you know, from a safety perspective. And they tend to, the cyclists like to be spread out like that. On that note, safety is our number one priority. It always has been, and it always will be. We spend the whole year working with towns, police, enforcement, state officials, anyone who wants to talk to us about our ride. We're there to talk to them. We educate our cyclists year round on rules of the road, good safety practices, and we'll do that up to the day and the day of the ride. Before we send them out, we give them one last safety speech, go over the rules of the road, and that good stuff. So I wanted to share with you, if you don't mind, this is, you probably got some earlier information, but these are cue sheets of our 50-mile route, and I've highlighted, to the best of my knowledge, where the cyclists, what roads the cyclists will be going on through Hampton, and please add to that if I've missed any roads on that cue sheet. we have gotten permission to use Hampton Academy as a rest stop, so that'll be a nice break for our 50-mile riders. So I just wanted to open it up to questions, comments, concerns. What you've experienced. This is my first full year managing this event, so I just wanted to hear from you on what your thoughts are.
Thank you very much,
sure.
Mr. McWilliam. Selectman Woolsey.
No, it looks great. You missed Little River Road. I'm proud of you.
Selectman Griffin.
No, I wish you a lot of luck with your event.
Thank you.
Selectman Wright.
It's a great event. Thank you.
Yeah, I wish you luck, and you know, you've done your safety homework here, and yep. You know, I think these are great events, and they raise money for charity, and they promote healthy recreation.
Yep, so that's the idea.
It's a super job.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
All right, and so we'll just get our signed.
Yeah, you are on the consent agenda for this evening, subject to approval. You've met all the requisites. You're hitting all the checkpoints and the check marks, so you're good to go.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. You know where to find us if you have other questions.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you very much. Roman 4, number 2, G. Stevens Davis, a request to waive false alarm invoice. Yes, sir. And please sit if you'd like to.
Good evening. My name's Steve Davis, and I thank you for allowing me the time to be with you, and I know you have a lot of important items on your agenda, so I'll try and be brief. I sent you a letter at the suggestion of Christina, and she was very helpful in giving me some guidance. Out of respect for your time, I'm not going to read my letter. I hope that you might have had a chance to read it, but I just have a couple of comments I'd just like to share with you to summarize. First of all, I want you to know that most of my friends and family would attest that I'm a fanatic about maintaining my property, which is down in Sun Valley by Beckman's Point. I take great pride in it, and this includes everything in my home, including my alarm system. I've had an alarm company to my home twice in 2013 for maintenance. The first time was on January 3rd to replace a wireless door transmitter, and then in August to replace my smoke and heat detectors. And then, as you know, the police department responded to my house alarm four times in 2013. The first alarm on February 18th was triggered by an interior motion detector sensor. I don't know if that was a false alarm or an actual person inside that may have gotten in through an unlocked window. Clearly, I had a problem last December with three alarms, one on December 26th and two on December 31st, both on December 31st, they were less than 2 hours apart. I called my alarm company after the December 26th alarm and asked them to check out the system. They told me they, due to the holidays, they're not able to get to the house until after the New Year's. While I was away on vacation, but I returned Labor Day and went into my home and bypassed the zone that was causing the problem. and I didn't want any more alarms. On January 6th, the company came and inspected the system and determined that the front door magnet had been moved and needed adjustment. They told me that sometimes homes older, as they get older, shift as a result of wider spaces in the door jamb, and heavy winds can cause the door to move, creating a false read. You may recall that during this time, we had a lot of northeast conditions, and the door faces directly to the northeast. So in summary, I've tried to maintain my home and my alarm system so it works properly. I realize that the police were notified four times in 2013, but I don't think all were false calls. My family does not place a lot of burden on the town or its resources, as we, at the present time, are only seasonal residents. We do hope, however, to become permanent residents in 3 or 4 years. We pay close to $15,000 in taxes, and we feel we should not have to pay extra to have the police check our home four times during the course of the year. I recognize false alarms are a nuisance, not only to the police, but for me too. I don't enjoy getting calls at 2 in the morning, and as such, I was on top of my alarm company to fix the problem, and this is long before I knew there were fines that are levied after 2 alarms. As such, I'm respectfully requesting that you waive this $100 fine, and I thank you very much for giving me consideration to my request.
Mr. Davis, thank you for coming in. Does the board have a pleasure? For Mr. Davis's request.
What's been the past practice that we...
I don't remember this ever happening before.
Fred, can you give us...
We... nothing's ever come to the board before. I'm sure there are false alarms, and they do, in accordance with the board's policy, they do send bills. None of them have ever been appealed, to my knowledge, to the board. Mm. So
have they been
paid? You're on soft ground. Unless they're abated for good cause by the police department, but
is this appealed to somebody before us?
You're the authority who makes the fines,
okay,
and you're the only ones who can, in fact, relieve it. So,
Mr. Chairman, I'll move to deny.
Is there a second? The motion fails for a second. Is there any?
I'll make a motion to allow it with the condition that it shouldn't really happen again.
Is there
and mainly I feel that way because I've not seen this happen either, and I was here for 9 years and never noticed someone else coming with this.
Is there a second? I will second that motion. All those in favor? Four. All those opposed? Woolsey opposing? Mr. Davis, it looks like that alarm is sentimental around New Year's Eve, so you might want to watch it next year. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
All right. Good night. Take care. Roman 4, number 3, Mr. DeMarco, presentation of funding to Fisher House at town offices at 11 a.m. on April 15th. Please, sir.
Okay. Sorry, I have to come up to the cane. Had a few appointing kind of because I got injured. As you're well aware of, Article 39, the last town meeting, was successfully passed by the voters of Hampton. We have been in contact with the Fisher House representative, and he's indicated to us that he was going to be arriving here on April 15th, Manchester Airport. We offered to pick him up, but he's going to provide his own transportation. He's going to be down here approximately 10:30 to 11 o'clock. We have also been in contact with Channel 9, and of course with Harold, and I think the Hampton Union is all one, on the efforts to make a presentation so that the town can get recognition for what they've done. From the Fisher House, it's my understanding that Hampton, along with all the other things we do, charity-wise, just what we did for the Heart Association, is one of the, probably the only community that he's aware of that's ever made a donation to this type of cause. And I can think of no better cause than supporting the wounded soldiers. So he's very grateful for the townspeople. Richard and I were just a peg in the road to get the thing rolling. That's it. The townspeople that did it, and they and they deserve recognition for it. We are a great town, and just only goes to prove how great we are. And I'd like to invite the chairman of the board to make the presentation on behalf of the town. And obviously, whatever selectmen like to be there also. And I think Christina thought it would be good for me to arrive this evening in case some of the townspeople would like to be there to accept the acknowledgement from the Fisher Foundation. Just in case you don't know what the Fisher Foundation is, real quickly, Richard explained it. He, by the way, he had a prior appointment. That's why he couldn't be here tonight. Three other times he's already explained it, but I'll do a real shot. It's an organization that came together on the belief that they might be able to offer some relief to the injured soldiers by providing residence, room and board, transportation for their family members to be near them while they're recuperating in various medical hospitals that are run by the service people. Obviously, the government didn't have enough money to do this, so they took it upon themselves as a private organization to do this. And that was the beginning of it, and they've built four of them or five of them right now, and I think the next one's in Portland, Maine. I'd like to say it was just only confined to Hampton residents, but I don't think any of us want it to be confined to anything. It's the soldiers, the servicemen, that we're hoping their families to be close by and helping with their recovery. And on behalf of, I'm sure they're going to thank you, but I think the townspeople deserve to thank you for what they did.
Thank you, Mr. DeMarco. Selectman Wilson.
Thank you for and Mr. Ballou for representing really the silent majority in this country who have served this country with distinction and very, very quietly go on their way. I've known Mr. Ballou for over, what, close to 40 years, and I never, ever understood that he served in Vietnam.
He's a war veteran.
Yeah.
Combat veteran.
And the
I'm a non-combat veteran.
Yeah. But the silent men who have served this country, and they deserve anything we can do for them. Thank you for what you've done, Victor.
Thank you, ma'am. Selectman Griffin.
Thank you very much for taking part in making this happen.
Thank you. Again, the townspeople deserve this.
Yes, yes, the townspeople do deserve, but it also it's out of you and Dick bringing that forward that made us aware of it. So,
yeah.
Thank you.
Great cause. Thank you.
Yeah. You know Mr. Ballou about as long as I have or longer. Yeah.
He's a fine gentleman.
Outstanding. Yeah.
Thank you, sir, and I echo Selectman Woolsey's comments to the team. Thank you very much. The best to Mr. Ballou.
See you
soon.
Would you be there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you very much.
I sent you an email this afternoon.
Yes, you did.
Thank you, sir.
We'll make sure he drills down.
Oh. Well, he's a veteran.
Thank you, sir. Roman 5, public hearing number 1, concurrence of appointment of tree warden. Town Council, sir.
We're here for the implementation of Article 34 that passed this last town meeting by a vote of 2,065 yes to 757 no. Under this, the town manager, with the advice and consent of the Board of Selectmen, is to appoint a tree warden, and then the tree warden shall promulgate rules and regulations after a public hearing. And so I think first order of business would be the appointment of the tree warden.
Mr. Welch?
I have sent you a request to concur in the appointment of Mr. Heath Noyes, the Director
Wonderful.
Of Public Works.
It's appropriate this time to have that motion.
Yes, to have the board give its advice and consent.
I'll so move.
Second.
And who is that? That is the going to be the tree warden?
The Director of Public Works, Mr. Noyes.
Thank you, ma'am. And there was a second by Mr. Bridle. All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you, ma'am.
Next to part two of this, the rules and regulations that the tree warden himself and the town manager have worked on this together. I've reviewed those, and a couple of changes have been made, and Mr. Noyes has concurred in those changes, and these are now in a form for under his promulgation, and what you would need now would be for the board to give its approval. I would just like to say by way of background that There are a number of provisions in the RSA's Chapter 231 that affect this, and the town manager has done a great job of going through these and incorporating them and verbatim in a number of cases, so that we're strictly following the RSAs in this regard.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Welch?
I think town council has said it all.
Thank you, sir. A motion, please.
I will so move, Mr. Chairman, that we adopt approval of the tree warden's rules and regulations relative to public tree preservation and protection effective this date.
Thank you. Second. Seconded by Mr. Waddell. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Roman 6, public hearing, RSA 31:95-e, Roman 2. 1, to accept a gift in excess of $5,000. In the town's behalf of a sidewalk dedication at 421 Lafayette Road. Mr. Coronado, please.
It's all right, I'll just stand up here for a moment. Joe Coronado, Jones of Beach Engineers, representing Swain Corner LLC. This is a piece of property on the corner of Swain's Court and Lafayette Road. It's been the old site of the gas station that we've been on for many years. So there's a couple things with this development that was recently conditionally approved at the planning board. There's right now there's a curb cut out on Lafayette Road right in the front. And with this development, we're looking to close off that curb cut, build sidewalk along Lafayette Road. There's a little bit of sidewalk out there, but it's getting kind of old and needs to be fixed up. So we're looking to replace the sidewalk out on Lafayette Road with a new sidewalk, put a radius on that sidewalk, because right now the two roads come together almost at a 90 degree angle. So we have a small 10 foot radius here. On this plan, the gray, dark gray portion is the part of the sidewalk that's on the town property. And the brown portion is sidewalk that the owner is going to build on his land. This one will be, the brown portion will be brick, and the town's would be asphalt. So there'll be a clear delineation of who's out of the field. And then we're also here tonight for the first floor of the building is going to be commercial. So we're here for the commercial trash pickup, as well as the building will have a basement.
Let's stick with public hearing for the acceptance of the gift. All right, we'll jump down to Roman 7, please.
Awesome.
Thank you. Mr. Welch?
Mr. Chairman, excuse me, this has been approved by the planning board, and the owner of property has said that he would like to see that sidewalk fixed and parking be proper along that street, installing curbing and a new surface for the sidewalk. It's recommended the town accept that gift.
I'll make that motion.
We're talking granite curbing, Fred?
And my understanding, yes.
And then an asphalt sidewalk.
Yes, the asphalt will match the sidewalk that's to the south of this area.
Right.
To the north of this area, it's
I'm familiar with
concrete.
It. Right. Joe, in the little transition on the north side, you have that little extra opening. How far is the granite curbing going to go there?
What's going to happen here is that
it's going to start there.
Yeah, we're going to tie into the existing sidewalk somewhere in here, depending on where the grout line is in the curbing today. And then this will all be new curbing.
Right.
And then right here we'll actually have a tip down for handicapped access. So the curbing will end about right here. This portion here will be flush to the street to allow people to wheel across or handicap access to the other side of the road, of Lafayette Road. And then on this, as it comes around the corner, there'll be another tip up, and the curbing will start again here and run down this side.
So you'll in effect have a small curb cut there just for pedestrian handicap, kind of just to the south of where you just had your finger?
Yes.
Okay.
Hmm. Yeah. To complicate it a little bit, then we'll have a curb on the inside, which will keep this sidewalk area level in front of the building, so it'll allow for people to come up, go up the ramp, and come in the door.
Fred, I don't literally remember, but we're going to have to reconfigure the parking spaces there, repaint, and get squared away?
They just have to be repainted.
Just repainted, okay.
There's any there now. There's the curb cut.
I can't remember.
They have been from time to time, but the curb cut has discouraged us sometimes from putting them there, but there will be standard parking spaces in front painted off.
Right, so there'll be some additional spaces.
Okay, good.
Thank you. Mr. Griffin, you have a motion. We'll have a second and continue discussion. Is there a second?
Second.
By Mr. Waddell. Yes, sir. Mr. Griffin, any further comments?
No, I saw it at the planning board, so.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Bridle?
All set.
Mr. Waddell?
Yes, sir.
A motion to accept. All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you very much. Roman 7 appointments. Mr. Coronado again. 421 Lafayette Road, approval of commercial solid waste collection by the town. Number 2, approval of sump connection to town catch basin. Mr. Coronado, please.
The first floor of this proposed building would be commercial, and as my understanding is, the town will pick up commercial trash on Lafayette Road with approval from this board, so that's why I'm here with that item. I can get into sump pump one too, or do you want to do them separately?
Let's stick with solid waste, and then we'll go to them. Selectman Wolsey, please.
I have a question.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
You're going to have, if the town were to be picking up the waste, you'd be storing the carts in the rear of the property, I'm assuming?
Yes,
and
they'll
kind
be
of wheeling them out.
Yes.
Now, I watched the zoning board a couple of nights ago, and you're talking about a single business in the front.
Yes.
So, do you have an anticipated number of carts because they have to be spaced?
Obviously, the number of carts is going to highly depend on the commercial use that goes in.
Right, but they have a very limited frontage there, and for the convenience of the mechanical packer, the carts have to be spaced so that the packer can get in and grip them and put them up. Have you made a rough count of how,
no.
I think those packers are at least 24 inches across, the larger ones probably a little more than that, so you'd need room.
We have 60 feet of frontage on Lafayette Road and 120 on Swain's Court. So
okay,
I think
60 feet.
I think there'll be, I'm not anticipating an overwhelming amount of trash coming out of this. The commercial space is about 1,800 square feet.
This is nothing personal for this particular developer, but I think, once again, it's time for us to make a clear statement to the planning board, and I'm going to be talking about this later on. We cannot continue to accept the responsibility for waste for all of the new commercial developments. It will drown us, so I'm going to bring that up later on, but no, with no particular prejudice to this development per se.
Any further questions, Selectman Wilson?
No.
Sir.
Now, I'm not sure if I'm right, Joe, but I thought you said that the commercial trash at the planning board, the barrels were going to be kept in the basement.
That is the basement.
I believe that's so true. The commercial is in the basement, and then the residential, there's some space out in the back of the building.
So it's in the back, they're going to put theirs on Swain's Court, and then the commercial would bring it out to the front.
I believe so. Does it?
What?
Does it, well, that's where I'm a little foggy, and I need guidance from the town, is that I don't know where the town stands on picking up residential trash in the downtown.
The deal with that, and I watched the meetings, was that the residents are going to dispose of their own waste, and there's this area. The basement is essentially the first floor. There's no underground basement in this development.
Just point of order. We are approving or not approving commercial solid waste. So let's stick to commercial solid waste, please.
We're not talking residential.
And well, it's where I'm just a little confused.
There is a basement too, isn't there?
No.
Yes.
Yes, there is.
Down below.
Yes, there is. The elevator goes to it.
It's a full basement. I mean, it's a 8-foot basement.
All right. Point of order here. What are you confused about? You have sought commercial solid waste collection by the town. Is your confusion going to prohibit you from seeking that approval here tonight?
No. The commercial trash is
I think, pretty clear to me. The confusing part is I'm not positive if the town picks up residential trash.
Okay, well, can we just stay away from residential? Right. Because what's on the agenda is all very right. specific, and it specifically says commercial solid waste. Are right. you unconfused now?
Yes.
Okay, great. Mr. Griffin, do you have any more questions?
No.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Bridle?
No.
Okay.
No.
Mr. Woodell? All right. Is there a motion, please?
Mr. Chairman,
sir,
before you make the motion,
yes, sir.
If you're going to make a motion, my suggestion is that the material be picked up on Swain's Court mm-hmm. because there's no parking on Swain's Court. Mm-hmm. There's going to be parking in front of this building on the main road, Route 1, and that could prohibit the trash from being picked up by the remote control units.
Yeah.
So Swain's Court would be the recommended position for those carriages or carts.
Mm-hmm. Does the board have a pleasure for a motion?
I'll make that motion.
By Mr. Griffin, incorporating the town manager's Swain's Court location for the barrels. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Mr. Woodell, all those in favor?
Four.
Selectman Woolsey is opposed. Thank Moving you. On, Mr. Coronati, number two, approval of sump connection to town catch basin. Please, sir.
All right. There's there is a basement proposed for this building. It's it's just storage space for the residents and storage space for the commercial. And it came up through the PRC process that it is a good idea to have a emergency overflow sump pump connection to a catch basin that's directly right in front of the property. And because the catch basin's in the town right of way, we need permission from the board to allow us to attach a sump pump connection to the catch basin in the event of a emergency where the basement needs to be pumped out.
Thank you. Selectman Wilson.
What happened to the oil tank under there? Because that was a filling station. Has anybody checked?
Yes, there's a we submitted it to the planning board, but I know you don't get a copy of that, all that stuff, but there's a clean bill of health from the DES from 2001, I think.
Okay.
For the James Zagaros, who was the owner of mm-hmm. White's gas station, so it's
that's a clean site.
It's been cleaned up and removed.
Okay.
And
that's a concern. So the sump pump would be located in what you're calling now the basement, the below ground area. Has anybody done a soil study of that particular lot? Is that wet? And I literally don't remember. Is
we have done
drainage a problem right there?
We have done a couple of test pits. The back of the parcel is gravel, so we were able to dig some
okay.
holes in that this winter, and we did not hit groundwater, but we did have it has about a 4-foot seasonal high water table. Mm. So that's obviously seasonal, but it's mm-hmm. but when we were out there, it was pretty dry.
Do you think this is sensible, Fred?
It's a good precaution, and rather than having the owner of the building get in a situation where he's going to pump out in the street.
Yeah, like High
that's
Street.
A bad situation. Now we have an opportunity because we have a catch basin directly in front of the building.
Mm-hmm.
As they're building the sidewalk, they can run a line out to it with a double backflow preventer on the line so that if the catch basin should fill for any reason, block up or fill, it will not flood back into
Excellent.
The building.
Excellent.
So
thank
okay.
you, sir.
That's
sir.
Good.
That was my only question, was if we had a backflow
yes.
on it. Just
I'll make that motion.
Okay, do you have any questions? Okay, thank you. The motion by Mr. Griffin. A second, please.
I'll second.
Seconded by Selectman Woolsey. All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you, Mr. Coronati.
Thank you very much.
Come back again, Joe.
Very welcome, sir. Approval of minutes, Roman 8, page number 1.
I will so move that we approve the minutes of whatever they were. Whoops, March 24th.
Second. Anybody exhibit a need to go through each page?
No.
I have one question, though, at the end, if I can. Here we go. On page 9 of 10, it says about a third of the way up from the bottom of the page, Mr. Selectman Griffin would like to know when they are going to discuss the calendar of meetings. He would like to see it go to every other week in the summer like it always was. And I made a comment, and then Selectman Bridle made a comment, and Chairman Bean said this will be on next week's agenda. I thought we voted on that on the spot, but I wouldn't swear.
We did.
Oh, it went to the next week. It went to last week.
This is
well, it's not on for this week, and I...
Actually, it is. It's consent item number 1.
Where? Oh, it's in mixed in with the...
It's right on the side, item number one.
That's tricky.
Have you answered your own question, Selectman Wilson?
Well, sort of, I guess. Okay.
The minutes then are without discrepancy. There's been a first, a second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you very much. Town Manager Report, number nine. Mr. Welch, please, sir.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, just a couple of notes that I received today. The town tax collector's office will be closed on the 16th of the month all day. She is required to attend certain trainings with the state of New Hampshire. And Mr. Paquette, the head of our IT department, has indicated to me after working with our telephone supplier that on Friday, April 18th, the Department of Public Works will be without telephone communications all day.
They'll love that.
We have apparently a broken line, and it needs to be replaced, and that's going to shut down the entire operation all day as far as phones are concerned. So that's something that just happened today. The State Department of Transportation will be holding an informational meeting at the Hampton Falls Town Hall on Wednesday, April 9th. That's this Wednesday. Concerning the replacement of the bridge and dam on Interstate 95, this is at the Taylor River. Please attend if you have an interest, and if you're a member of resident of Hampton, you should have an interest. The public viewing of materials will begin at 6:30 p.m., and the presentation by the state DOT will begin at 7 p.m. Public Works has begun a trial recycling of books and clothing together with the Big Hearted Books and Clothing Company Incorporated for a 12-month period. Bins should be placed soon at the transfer station. This is revenue producing for us. It's not much, but it's 1 cent per pound for books recycled. Per your discussion last week, we have presented a proposed schedule for the 2:14 selectmen's meetings, which is on the consent agenda. It has meetings every other week, beginning with Memorial Day and ending with Labor Day in the summertime. A week from tomorrow is the last opportunity to submit to the assessing department applications for veterans, elderly, and other exemptions. Please come in and visit the department if you have an exemption you need to submit. There is paperwork you need to do and you need to fill out, and assessing can help you do that. I provide the board with a schedule of wage increases for non-union employees that have been in place in the budget by the previous board. The increases total $21,744. For the 37 employees, or 1.25% each. The Portsmouth Garden Club has provided a grant to Marilyn Wallingford to maintain the Morelli Square town area. Thank you for both of them for the generous gift and for Marilyn for her maintenance and efforts to keep the town looking wonderful. DPW has begun a trial program to dispose of bulky waste at Eco Maine to see how it affects our overall expenses versus hauling a material to the turnkey landfill in Rochester. That's about to start. Hopefully that will represent a better proposal for us to get rid of sofas and stuffed chairs and things of that nature. Thanks to Representative Emmerich, we have received a copy of the draft 10-year State Transportation Improvement Plan. Hampton is listed as part of the 9.7-mile rail purchase from Hampton to Portsmouth for $1,022,000 in 2015. For an engineering study on improvements to Ocean Boulevard for $250,000, and for rehabilitation of the Route 1A Underwood Bridge that is red-listed as a priority project number 19 for the state for the year 2018 at an estimated cost of $6,909,000. A copy of that report will be in my office for anybody who wishes to read it. Household Hazardous Waste Day is May 17, 2014 at 8 a.m. to noontime in the old courthouse lot on Winneconnet Road. The announcement for the information is on the town website. Please review it because there are things they will not accept. There are also things that they will charge for that you need to know about, please, before you bring them. There are two items before the legislature that the board should be aware of. The first is Senate Bill 228. That will change the noticing requirements for zoning changes. The second is Senate Bill 237 that would change the notice requirements for condominiums. Please see the legislative bulletins. For those who are going to be naturally curious about what that all means, and you should be, because it's not a particularly a wonderful thing for the town to be involved in, I just pull out that document. There it is. Senate Bill 228 will change zoning notice requirements. If the proposed amendment to a zoning ordinance would change a boundary in a zoning district, or the uses, setbacks, or lot sizes in a district would change, and would affect 500 or fewer properties, notice to a public hearing for the amendment shall be sent first-class mail to each and every property affected. There's a catch to this. If you miss one of them, the entire thing is void. So you've got to go back and do it all over again. The other one is Senate Bill number 237, and that deals with notice requirements for condominiums. That would require the Land Use Board, regardless of which board it is, it's any Land Use Board, to do condominium the officer's job for them. It changes the definition of abutter to say that if an abutting condominium property consists of 100 or fewer units, the term abutter includes each and every owner rather than the officers of the unit. Mm. So if you get into zoning and there is a zoning change, everybody in the condominiums is going to have to be notified if they're within that district. And if you're in a subdivision or a site plan, everybody will have to be notified if they're if that condominium is located within the site plan distance. So.
Well, oftentimes
just so everybody knows.
People in Florida for the winter, and the condominium chief condominium person doesn't get notified, so nobody gets notified. So
thank
I
you. If I may, Mr. Welch, are you done?
Sure. The problem really here is that somebody's got to sign that card and return it.
Yeah.
If you don't sign the card and return it, we may have to do it all over again, whether you're in Florida or not. So these people may have to register with us when they go away. It's going to get to be a really big problem, I think. But just for your information, so if you would and you have a concern about it, call our representatives and express your concern, please. I'm finished, sir.
Thank you. Questions for the town manager, Selectman Wilson.
Joint operation plan, where are we?
Still awaiting the state's response.
Oh, I'm so surprised. Yes. And how about that highway grant sheet that you read? Has the state come up with the rest of the money for the bridge over the Great Bay yet, or are we just talking?
I only looked up the Hampton.
Hypotheticals here.
I only looked up the Hampton proposals.
Yeah.
Great Bay is my understanding, is being funded. How it's being funded, I don't know.
I think they were $80 million short the last time. I just am interested in all the money they're waiving for these grants.
Can't answer that one for you.
Selectman Griffin.
No, nothing. Thank you.
Fred, have you talked with the representatives in Concord, our representatives, about the SB, the two Senate bills?
I've not. I just read them today, so I haven't had a chance to talk to anybody at this point.
All right. But it's crucial that we all talk to them, probably.
They'll listen to the selectmen faster than they'll listen to anybody else.
Yep.
But it's crucial to preserve the rights of the abutters as well.
Right.
Thank you, Mr. Welch.
Sir.
Roman 10, old business. Number one, health trust property liability and workers' compensation coverage renewal. Town council, please, sir.
Yes, the thing that prompts this to be on your agenda at this time is that health trust, which is the now owner of the property liability and workers' compensation trusts, had sent through its underwriting and coverage manager a looks like sort of an all-points bulletin that says you still have time, renew your coverages today. They're talking about the coverages that go into effect July 1 for the year July 1, 2014 to June 30, 2015. And they say remember to renew by April 15. It catches us a little off guard because up until now they've been saying May 15. And I, not knowing exactly what this was all about, I called up the Chief Operating Officer Wendy Parker of the Health Trust and asked her, Wendy, what's this all about? We all thought it was May 15th. And she said to me, well, this is a sort of a pre-renewal procedure, which isn't committing you to it, but gets you to input your information so that by the time May 15 rolls around, you can effectuate a more efficient renewal. So that's at least the explanation. We have looked at this question before of what to do about our coverages for property liability and for workers' comp when the issue was what is the going to be the viability of those two trusts. That was before they were taken over by the health trust. And this was in November of last year, and the prior board directed that the manager put out these two types of coverages for bids, and the two coverages came in with Primex, only two, Primex, and then the other was PLT, which is now Health Trust. There was a difference in cost in favor of PLT being $63,451.24 less. There is another wrinkle that comes into play in this regard, which is Health Trust was ordered, the decision of the hearing officer in the Bureau of Securities Regulation case, it was ordered that the property liability trust pay back to Health Trust, and now they're part of one entity, $17.1 million that had been loaned by Health Trust to property liability trust to start a workers' compensation pool. This was a number of years ago. The hearing officer found that that should instead have been distributed as surplus rather than loaned, and therefore he ordered that money to be paid back by December 1 of last year, and then in turn distributed to the members of Health Trust. That particular ruling was upheld by the New Hampshire Supreme Court in a decision dated January 10, 2014, at which time it came, an agreement came to light which had not been made public before, whereby Health Trust took over the property liability trust. And so the question now is, can the Health Trust do this part two, which is paying back to the members, to its members, who should have gotten the $17.1 million a number of years ago, can it now pay that back? And so on April 1, just not April Fool's, I guess it is April Fool's Day, yeah, Health Trust sent out an email from Peter Bragdon, the executive director, saying, we are going to give back $13.9 million on or after June 30, 2014. Just to give you an idea of what that means, I had sent the board a pricing sheet from the finance director. We've been tracking this all along, what that would mean to the town and its employees. If that money is distributed, $13.9 million, the town would receive $97,500, and employees and retirees would receive approximately $52,500 distributed among them, just as has been the case with prior distributions of surplus. So if and when the $13.9 million comes around, $150,000 would be gross, would go between the town and its employees. And so the question that we had asked was, do we need still to be members of the property liability trust in order to receive part of that distribution? And I had given the board an answer about that over the weekend and rethought about it and sought clarification from Wendy Parker and got that today. And the point of that is we only need to be member of Health Trust in order to receive that distribution. We don't need to still be a member of the Property Liability Trust. So we have that flexibility. So there's still the consequence of the $63,000 difference between Primex and Health Trust in favor of Health Trust. But the concern about will we get a portion of the $13.9 million, do we have to still keep those two coverages, liability and workers' comp? The answer is no, we don't. we just have to keep the health trust coverage, which is the health insurance, medical and dental.
Wonderful. And Mr. Welch, your comments, please.
That's today.
That's today.
That could change tomorrow.
It yes. could change tomorrow.
And that's what concerns me. Yeah. Because in the past, they have said, if you're not a member, you get nothing. And there's still a considerable amount of money after this refund is made that needs to come back to the town from years prior
yes.
to that.
Yes.
The other thing is, I don't have $63,451.24 in the budget to pay for the switch of insurance coverages. Unless the board transfers it from some department budget to the insurance line. Frankly, I don't know which department can afford $63,000 to be transferred away from it so that we don't have the opportunity to renew.
Thank you, sir. Selectman Woolsey.
For Mark. All the assets and liabilities of the Property Liability Trust have been assumed by the Health Trust under an agreement that took effect upon the date of the Supreme Court's decision on January 10th. How binding is that? That was done ex parte. It was done without the knowledge of the Supreme Court, as I understand. Has anybody said anything about whether the legality of that move will stand?
The Board of Securities Regulation in front of the Secretary of State has
yep.
filed a motion to challenge that. There has been an answer to that by the Health Trust, obviously,
sure.
Saying that it is legal.
Yeah.
And when and if we ever get an answer to that question, maybe sometime.
I fail to understand how the statement can be made that if we're not a member of whichever of the units at the time the checks go out, that we can be deprived of the surplus money that should have been turned into us from this alleged non-profit organization. If we were a member of Health Trust and or Property Liability Trust on the relevant dates that this money is being grabbed from, the relevant dates where these people are now being forced to surrender their ill-gotten gains, how can they do that legally? If we legally were participants in this thing, which we have been all along, unfortunately, how can they look us in the eye and say, well, if you're not a member in the future, if you're not a member July 1st, then you won't get any money back? What legal standing do they have to say that?
Well, this is
I see
yeah.
court.
This is a part of their bylaws.
Oh, that's
that
wonderful.
They've had all along that in order to receive distributions back of yes. things, you need to be a member. The entity that loaned the money will be the entity distributing it, which is Health Trust, and we have been. Well, we've been members of all their trusts right along,
right.
But I doubt that we're ever going to, unless a miracle happens and very inexpensive health coverage comes
mm-hmm.
along, I imagine we're still going to be a member of that aspect of it.
So we don't have to worry about it, but still I would question the legality of even making a statement like that.
That particular aspect of it hasn't been subject to those lengthy proceedings, and I would hate to think we would be the source of those proceedings.
I just find it outrageous that this is a purported not-for-profit operating under the laws, and I hold the legislature accountable for this stuff, too, operating in the town of Hampton and defrauding the taxpayers and defrauding the employees and the retirees, Mr. Bridle, right, of their the money that should have been returned to them years ago. And I agree with Fred because we're talking 2003 to 2009 as well. There's a lot of money involved here. And this is all taxpayer money. And I'm not happy at all with these charades that they're pulling. And I appreciate the work you're doing, unfortunately. You're dealing with less than honorable individuals.
Selectman Griffin, please.
No, thank
Selectman
you.
Selectman Bridle.
I think Mary Louise spelled it out pretty good.
Yeah, I think she spelled out pretty good, and we all know the history of it and stuff, but the fact fact of the matter is, isn't it, that it's Fred, that's going to cost us more if we did switch?
$63,000 more, the minimum.
And if we were to do something in court, it's going to cost us there, right? And if we weren't members, you take the chance that you don't get the money back.
That's
so
correct.
We want to take those chances. I think we have to make a decision.
Right.
Where do we want to be? You know, logically speaking, do we want to spend more money? Do we want to, you know, to make I agree with the principle, but to make a principle, do we, you know, I think we got to think it through.
The good aspect of it is that for pricing considerations, if things don't go the way Altress thinks they will go, we have the ability to cancel our coverage that we do take at any time, and we have explored, and Primex will accept us at any
correct.
Time.
Good.
And if we do pay the year's premium, things go south, we get back the prorated part that we haven't used.
Right.
That was one of our inquiries.
Thank you. Okay. Yes, Ms. Wilson.
One quick follow-up. Do we have any vague feeling of confidence moving forward? Because we've been tangled up in the mess of the past, do we have any hope that there will be extra scrutiny, extra supervision, extra enforcement of this entity moving forward? Or are we going to have to be fighting over this every year? Is there anything coming out of BSR, anything out of the state, out of the AG's office, anything to give towns some measure of comfort if we're stuck going forward because of money?
I think one good thing to note from my experience with them for many years is that the property liability insurance is very well administered. The workers' comp is also very well administered, and we've saved a lot of money by having those coverages. In terms of this loan that occurred a number of years ago, of course, we didn't have any say in that. Certainly, the local government center is now under extreme scrutiny.
It's about time.
They can't breathe without people saying, oh my gosh, what did you just do? Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, at times, they still do things, which is very puzzling. But we can say that they won't get away with it for long if they do.
I mean, they've squirreled away God knows how much money in CDs on into the future. A good 45 years since on into the future. I mean, there's money there, too.
Well, the BSR now, at least they're keeping an eye on it, which is good.
Oh, I know.
But we can foresee getting rebates or refunds every year from now on, I would think, can't we?
I think that's right.
Because
that's
correct. I think the last hearing I went to them, even their own actuary said, we don't ever get it right.
That's right.
You know, but they always do it in their favor, so we're going to be seeing rebates come back every year.
Thank you. Any further discussion or questions for the
Thank
board?
Thank you, Mark, for all
Thank
your
you.
Work on that.
And
Thank
do you need a motion for renewal? Do we need any administrative action, or what is the course of action going forward, please, for the renewal?
I think it's going to be of assistance to indeed input this data by April 15th, and indeed to, from an economic point of view,
right.
To renew by keeping our options open should the worm turn.
Wonderful, wonderful. So, again, does there need to be a motion by the board to renew, or is this in the hands of the town manager, finance director, and you, sir?
No, that would be in the board's hands.
Okay, and do you need a motion this evening for the renewal?
I think it would be helpful at this point
and
for us to be able
for
to...
And for the health, trust, property liability, and workers' compensation coverage renewal?
It would. I think we're already approved for the health trust renewal.
We are. We might as well include it because it's all been one organization now. So.
Sure.
Could council phrase the motion?
Thank you, ma'am. Yes, sir, please.
If the board would move to authorize a renewal of the coverages available under health trust, property liability trust, and workers' compensation.
Thank you, sir.
Also
for the year July 1, 2014 to June 30, 2015.
Correct. Thank you, sir.
I will accept that and move and so move.
A second, please.
I'll second.
Moved by Mr. Waddell. All those in favor? Unanimous?
I'm opposed.
And Mr. Bridle is opposing. Did I get that right? 4-1?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Roman 10, number 2, sunsetting of Recycling Education Committee. Selectman Wolsey.
Yes, I appreciate the information to refresh our memory, especially the reference to the vote taken on June 16, 2008, the Recycling Trash Committee created by the then Board of Selectmen. I sat on that initial committee, which was chaired by Mr. Lally. I believe he chaired that for 2 years. And I know he got excited when I would refer to trash, but the title of it was Recycling and Trash. And we must have had at least 10 members of that committee. Very active committee. Mr. Lally was in control. He was at every meeting. He supervised what was the topics that were covered, and any requests from department heads. Mark Richardson was there. Al Davis came from Waste Management. Charlie Preston, and Jane.
Insalda.
Her last name, yes. So that was a very lively, very active group, and I remember that, to the best of my recollection, was about 2 years, and when Mr. Lally left, the newer iteration, if I may put it that way, of the Recycling Committee took shape. Mr. Pierce, in his capacity as a member of the Board of Selectmen, sat in as the Selectman representative in those recycling meetings, and I don't remember how long, Mike, that you were in, but I sat with the group for a while. I think certainly there's no question as to the dedication, and I have long been a proponent of recycling as well since the 80s when we first brought in waste management. It was not mandatory, but we brought in waste management with those little green boxes to pick up the waste. I think the time has come for us to now let the manager and public works director and Mr. Richardson and all of our other staff handle what needs to be done. I don't think that we need to maintain selectmen committees ad infinitum. So I would move that we sunset, with great thanks, the Town of Hampton Recycling Committee, effective March 31st, 2014.
Pending further discussion, is there a second? Mr. Griffin.
I would just like to say that I'm not going to really mention any names because I don't think it's necessary, but except the two ladies that are here, and they were, I think, both pretty, well, I know Tony was active right from the very beginning, and Corinne also has been there for some time, but I think where we went wrong at one point is, I think a lot of different people went to became active in the Recycling Committee to try to push their agenda. And I don't think it had anything to do with these two ladies that are here tonight. And I think that that's where there was some dissatisfaction. And I think what the committee really should be about and what it was intended to be about at the beginning, which Corinne has said, voiced it tonight, is about education. And it should be an educational board that serves at the pleasure of the Board of Selectmen. And I think that's why there was some undercurrents of people on the Board of Selectmen to be unhappy, because we were looking at people jockeying for position on that board. And I don't think that had anything to do with the ladies and Tammy that's here tonight. I don't think that was their agenda. So where it stands now, I think, as far as I'm concerned, I don't have as much a problem with it as long as it's about education. And I hear what the rest of the board feels.
For the record, there was a motion to sunset 31 March 2014. There is no second going forward. Mr. Bridle?
I think it's always good that you can have education and you can teach people. I mean, if that's what this committee, if we decide that's what this committee's going to be, I understand there was, as Rick said, there was some jockeying in the past, and we need to let our department heads run that department. We need to let the town manager work with our department heads and run that. If we decide to have a committee that would be for education and getting people to recycle better, I would not have a problem with that. So.
Thank you. Mr. Waddell?
Yeah, in researching this and talking with one of the members on the committee, you know, I come up with sort of the same conclusion that Rick and Rusty come up with, that as long as it's a strictly educational committee and not an enforcement committee, and I think that's where you get in trouble, and not a committee necessarily that's directly working with departments and stuff, but it's an educational and just dealing with recycling, I see no problem either.
One thing, sir, I wanted to mention, too, and I think pretty much when all of this started, Keith was really new, too. And I think it was mentioned tonight about the bag and tag, and that, you know, that a lot of people felt differently about it. And Keith had the experience of being in Exeter where they had it. And so it just got, everything got just thrown in. And I think the focus about just educating about the recycling was lost somewhere along the line.
That's crucial, to stay out of the trash issue and just in the recycling issue and just simply educational on recycling.
May I make a comment?
Stand by, please. Yes, ma'am.
If you're going in that direction and understand that I do not like the concept of continuing committees of the Board of Selectmen, I don't think that's a good precedent to set. But if it is the will of this board to go in that direction, I would strongly suggest that there should be a selectman representative party to that board as a member of that board to make sure that the effort stays on the straight and narrow and there is no movement into policy setting or grabbing up department heads or arbitrary actions off the actual education venue.
Thank you, ma'am. That's round two for Selectman Woolsey. Any second bites from the board? It appears that the board does want to preserve its existence. It does appear that they have one official member. It does appear that there's a consensus in the board that there will be an education role for the committee, and quite frankly, they do some wonderful things with that. And we just heard a presentation tonight, but it will not be into policy such as searching trash, creating how trash might be inspected, policy level decisions that have quite frankly come up during my tenure on this board. Mm-hmm. Keith, Director Noyes, runs a substantially huge department, the largest in this town. He has to encounter the interrogatories of the Board of Selectmen. He has a boss to my right, Mr. Welch, and he does a darn good job. So, Corinne, you wanted the last say on this, it appears.
It doesn't have to be the last say, but I'll say. Just that.
Yeah, would you please up at the microphone? Thank you.
When I came on the board, I think in 2011, I realized how new everything was and what changes were made. The previous Department of Public Works guy had left. The town had a mandatory recycling thing. We were starting at July 1st, the worst possible time to start a recycling or trash program in a resort community. And then we didn't have the carts here on time. We didn't know what sizes we were going to give. It was a disaster. Mm-hmm. Then the suggestion came from the selectmen, well, you know, don't just stick with the recycling. Now, you know, go into the trash information and then go back and see, can we do better at recycling if it's a bag and tag? What other communities are doing bag and tag? We called every place from San Francisco to West Hartford, Connecticut, getting information on bag and tag or how they do it, what size carts they give. So we were researching for it, where we just wanted to do the education. Just, this is what you need to recycle. This is how you do it.
Thank you.
And now we have the gal from EcoMaine that came and gave us great information.
So you would not disagree with the consensus of the board tonight that it's strictly from an educational standpoint?
That's all we wanted to do. That's all it should be.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Might I suggest, Mr. Chairman, that there be a motion to reconstitute this committee as...
What was yours? Please frame that.
Just as a suggested motion to reconstitute the Hampton Recycling Education Committee and to accept volunteers as potential nominees for the term.
Thank you, sir.
Is that the official name of the Recycling Education Committee?
It will be now. Several names.
I know. I think that's part of the problem. That was part of the problem, and that's how the focus was lost. So I think that there's been a lot that's been learned here. I'll make that motion.
Seconded by?
I'll second it.
With the stipulation as to a member of this board participating and overseeing.
I agree with that.
Let me just kind of chair this, because that's why you pay me the big bucks. Those are two separate issues. Is there an agreement or a second to Mary Louise's amendment?
Why is it a separate issue?
Mr. Gerald made the motion. It was approved by, may I please? It was approved by Mr. Griffin. It was seconded. You have modified it. Now, is there a second on the modification? Seeing none, the motion stands originally. All those in favor? Four. Ms. Woolsey?
I am opposed.
Okay,
you are not
4-1.
Going to end up by not controlling this any more than
thank
the last
thank you very
board.
Much. 4-1. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
And if I may, Corinne, good luck on your team tonight.
Here
we go.
I think, Mr. Chairman, you had seconded Bert's motion, I believe. Is that right?
There was no second, and the
I thought it was. I thought it was. Let's get this down.
Okay. Whoop. And council
Excuse me.
Motion.
Just a second, please, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay. For the record,
you having fun yet?
Proposed by you, Jim. Was it you or me?
I seconded.
That's what I thought. Seconded by Mr. Waddell, 4-1 for the Recycling Education Committee, and Ms. Woolsey was opposed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our discussions have terminated on that issue. Thank you very much.
Just correcting your
thank
statement,
you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, ma'am. I appreciate
council
it.
Council does not make motions. He proposed wording.
It was exactly the same process that preceded before when you had him make the motion for the PLT. Roman 10, number 3, Aquarian Water Company, 2014 Wicked Charge Update.
Okay. I've got a stack of stuff about yay high that has come in since we went through our last rate case with the decision by the PUC last end of June, and so I've been reluctant to flood you with this stuff. What we have in between rate cases for the last several years is that there is a water infrastructure conservation adjustment charge, better known as WICA. This is a charge that is imposed for construction work that is completed by Aquarian in the prior year. It's not construction work in progress, but it's for construction work completed. And this is a charge that is in a pilot mode still. This is the fourth year of it. And what it involves is that when the company proposes projects ahead of time to the PUC for their pre-approval, and then once they know they have that, they proceed to implement those, and then they come before the PUC and ask for a charge that will essentially guarantee that the cost is repaid over time. And every year for the past 3 years, there have been approval of these in the range of 1 to 2%. And there is a cap between rate cases of 7.5%. They can't go above that. The thing is, once they implement the percentage in a given year, it continues to future years so that they're cumulative. And so, having been granted a rather sizable rate increase over our opposition this last June, the company decided to do things a little bit differently to soften the blow of having another WICA charge come right at the end of the year. What they did was they merely, in October, proposed the list they asked for approval of the projects they had done in the prior year because there had been a change in the list. The change in the list was to our benefit because what they did was they substituted some pipe replacements, main replacements, for Auburn Avenue Extension, Auburn Avenue, and Perkins Avenue to dovetail with our work on the sewers in those projects. Knowing that when we do a sewer replacement and repave, we then have a five-year moratorium on the replacement of on the disturbance of the surface. So it behooves them, when we do our work, for them to do their work. And if they can justify that those pipes are just as old as other ones they would have replaced, it makes sense for them to dovetail on their efforts. So that's what they did. And so they weren't proposing that the charge in the fall be immediately imposed as of January 1. They said instead, well, we want to propose that this time for April 1 to give the consumer a break. Well, that was nice, and we didn't oppose that. Then they came along with another nice idea, which was that they had submitted for some new tax breaks for projects that they had done since 2007, and apparently are going to get that money from Uncle Sam to the tune of about $833,000. So they're proposing to essentially give that back to consumers over a three-year time period. So on the one hand, they're proposing to give money back, and then on the other hand, they're proposing to take some more money in the form of a WICA charge. Now, the money they're proposing to charge for WICA now at about 1.36% is about $94,778. Realizing that the money they would give back is more than they would be taking, they're being nice about it, and they're saying, well, let's not give us the authority to make the rate change for WICA as we normally would, but also allow us not to charge it while we calculate this credit that's coming along later. And so that's the whole of the paper at this point. I would say to you that we have opposed WICA in the past because the WICA charge adds on to the rate base ad infinitum. It sounds like a little bit for a while, but over the long run you continue to pay it, and so the payback becomes very large. Whereas, as Fred proposed to the commission in the rate case, if we were proposing a five-year bond, it would be a lot larger, but it would be paid back much quicker. And so, unfortunately, Fred's thoughts on that, the PUC, in its wisdom, rejected those and said, "We're going to do it the way we always did, and we're going to put it on the same recovery will be on a depreciation schedule."
88 years.
Yeah, not a 5-year bond schedule. So that's where that stands. And I've been asked by the utility analyst who sent out this latest thing to get back to them and give them our feedback on the subject. And I would propose to you that I get back to them and say, thank you, this is a nice idea. You've heard our problems before and rejected them. We still feel that we don't like the way you're doing this, but nevertheless, thank you. That's what I propose.
Selectman Woolsey, please.
You've done a great job, Mark. What What a mess. Oh, well.
Thank you. Sir?
No, I happened, was invited by Aquarian Water to go over there, and he explained this to me very similar to the way that you described it. It's interesting. Thank you.
Thank you. Selectman Brito.
No.
Selectman Liddell. Thank you. Mr. Welch, any comments?
It's what I refer to as highway robbery. They're going to charge you that 1% for 88 years. They're going to renegotiate the loan they made for at the end of the 88 years, and they're going to renegotiate and re-loan that money out to themselves again and charge you for the same for another 88 years. You don't need a gun and a mask to rob anymore. You just need the Public Utilities Commission to assist you.
Thank you, Mr. Welch. Roman 10, number 4, 3 through 5, H Street, or Crest. Let me just back up, and of course we concur, and there's a consensus with your recommendation to say thank you very much. May I have another, please? Number 10, number 4, 3 to 5 H Street, request for policies change to lease for leased land. A, addendum to mortgage assignment clause to allow third-party financing. Please, join the table.
Okay. Good evening, Board. My name is Attorney Ted Morris, and I have submitted this proposal for an addendum to a ground lease which this board executed last week for the property at 3-5 H Street. The town's ground lease form for its leased land program specifically authorizes a lessee to encumber its leasehold interest in the ground lease in paragraph 17. And the language in 17 is specifically identifies a bank as the financing entity. My client, for whom you executed the ground lease last week, is getting his financing through his seller. He's purchasing the Hillcrest Inn and the lot out back, which is 3-5 H Street. So the concept or the spirit of the lease is there to authorize a lessee to encumber his leasehold interest. The issue here is, and it's specific as to a bank, the issue here is the seller is actually doing the financing. So I've requested sort of an administrative housekeeping change to the lease that would allow my guy to grant his leasehold mortgage to the seller who's financing the property.
Thank you, sir. Seems simple enough. Selectman Wilson.
Nothing at the moment. Thank you. I did read the...
Selectman Griffin.
All set.
Selectman Liddell.
All set.
The pleasure of a board for a motion.
I'll make the motion to allow that.
And that would be to approve the...
Yes.
Yep. Please.
We've been presented with a addendum prepared by Attorney Morris, and I've reviewed that, and that's fine as to form. So I think it would be to sign the form.
Wonderful. Amending the lease to any third-party lender, is that correct?
Yes.
Thank you. And the motion, the second, all those in favor? Unanimous? Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Well, we've had a long time for 1 minute.
Huh? Well done.
His bill just went up, though.
Yeah. Roman 10, number 5, request for Department Public Works Director agenda item. Selectman Woolsey, the floor is yours, ma'am.
You're a brave man. 2 weeks ago, when we sat here, I asked about being able to meet with the Public Works Director. I think I even asked you if you could clear the schedule so that we could talk with him. His department really is the focal point for a lot of what's going to be going on with us this year. I was told not next week, which was last week, but the following week, which is this week, and he's still not here. When I talked to Fred a couple of days ago, he mentioned that he thought that Keith would be in May. A, I think it's unacceptable to have more than a month's time to bring in department heads. And I did a little thinking over the weekend, and I want to run a few things by you. I understand Mr. Waddell mentioned that as long as we have work to do here, he's happy to be here and in meetings. And indeed, we have a great deal of work to be done. Well, see, you inspired me too. At the moment, and I mentioned it last week, we have, for 2013, we have an unassigned, unreserved balance of $5,852,845. And the DRA is requesting that we reserve 5 to 7%, I believe, Fred, in case of emergency. If you look at our gross exposure for the 2011, 2012, and 2013 tax appeals, including the interest, and this is Next Era, which is Seabrook, and the other utilities, and a few property owners, et cetera. At the moment, we have a gross exposure from tax appeals, court, and BTLA, $2,584,330.08. Money is not looking too nice at the moment. The Taylor River Bridge and Dam, and Fred and the department heads will be going to the meeting on Thursday or Wednesday, whenever it is. There's possibility of contamination exposure to this town as well, which could result in rather large legal expenses depending on the manner in which the state chooses to move forward. High Street drainage, I will recollect, the Public Works Director segregated $30,000 out of the 2014 budget for the drainage account. I'm not sure when our starting date is, Fred, but I'm guessing sometime
close.
In September,
yeah.
After the summer season has gone by, but that $30,000 will have gone by since we got the default budget. Will it have
done
that?
No, it was reserved.
It was reserved?
It was reserved.
Okay. The Southeast Regional Refuse District, which the town authorized us to withdraw from, still presents an exposure to us. We have not yet withdrawn. And the way they are proceeding, I understand there's some risk of exposure there and money for us. We talked about the fire inspection, I think the first inspector position, the first night we sat down here. It is now April. It is April. And by October, we will have, theoretically, the budget for 2015 ready for the budget committee. And the summer will have gone. And we may still be sitting here without doing anything. And I propose to you that you have the A block coming up. Mr. Rage is building a building. You have a lot of building going on down there. We have not even made the first steps toward looking for the money in the budget to hire the fire inspector. And you're going to have, if you're going to place the chief and the FPO again in the situation of trying to keep up with all this stuff, God help us. You're going to have businesses phoning and raising
May I, as a point
no?
of order, ma'am, and not to interrupt you, but number five, in per your request,
yes.
In your email to me, the request is not for fire issues or anything other than the DPW director agenda items.
I can do this under any other old business then, if I may, because I am concerned about if businesses are calling me this spring like they did last spring, I'm going to say, tough luck, don't call me if you can't open in time. And that's business, and that's money. And we need time to get a fire inspector on board, and we need time to get him trained and acclimated. And I see the days flying by here. And the EMS fund, I'm not happy about
Ma'am, just for a point of order,
yes.
Because we have an agenda and department heads prepare for this and the board does, we can come to your other points with your other departments under old business, but specifically where you are, we are on Department of Public Work Director agenda items. You email me the 4/3/2014 and you ask specifically for some 9 items. So if we could stick to that,
director.
And then we can go to your other department
right.
Under old business, if you choose to.
Okay,
thank
I'm
you.
Trying to. When Keith appears.
I have a copy of your email if you need it.
Okay, I was going to say I had my copy,
here
but
go,
I have a
right,
mess
okay.
here. Oh, good. Thank you. Oh, yes. The update on the preparations for the sewer bond article for the Exeter Road reconstruction. I think we need to know month by month, have an update on that. That is going to be a very complicated project. It's going to involve a complete reconstruction of that road, plus all the drainage, plus the sewer line potentially, and all the utilities underneath. I think we have no time to lose if we're going to be presenting this for 2015. the update on current efforts to set up the stuffed furniture Fred has already addressed, and I think that's a very good move, and pull the weight of the mattresses and the furniture, stuffed furniture, out of the waste stream that's going to Turnkey. So that should have some effect in reducing our tipping fees up at Turnkey. Capital Reserve Fund, I think it's never too early to start looking toward that. I'm going to suggest for 2015 that we set aside $400,000. We have $600,000 now after the vote last month, and we are going to need to build that account up because the condition of the roads is an absolute disgrace. Fred mentioned, and I concur with him, and we need a serious focus on the number of employees needed to be assigned to the highway projects for the spring, summer, and fall seasons. Last conversation, I think it was last week, Fred said three members of the Public Works Department to be assigned to highways. What are we going to do with that? We're going to have to sit down and talk about that because employees don't grow on trees unless we're prepared to go around hiring more public works employees, and I don't see that in my crystal ball. How are we going to get through the summer season, gentlemen? Just the potholes alone. How are we going to get through the summer season with road and highway maintenance with three employees? And that's what we had last year. And it's getting worse and worse and worse, and we've got to sit down and talk about it. I think we should at least look at a potential reduction in frequency of collection for the properties townwide, except for the once-a-week residential collections. You talk about me continuing to bring up trash, and I will continue to bring up trash, and I will say that I'm at the point. I know I spent quite a bit of time with Keith and Chris Jacobs last year, and I'm at the point of moving that we rename the Public Works Department the Hampton Trash Department. 40% to 50% of our Public Works Director's time spent on collecting trash and issues with collecting and disposing of trash, in my mind, is absolutely unacceptable. And when I mentioned, by the way, the fees, I think, for the pay scale for collecting on weekends, I will stand corrected. Apparently, the men who are working on Saturdays and Sundays are paid time and a half, but that indicates to me, and tell me if I'm wrong, Fred, that some of them are pulled out of the weekly schedule in order to dedicate their time to the weekends, which means that we're running short Monday through Friday on personnel. No?
No, they're working full-time during the week.
They're working full-time during the week plus Saturday and Sunday?
Yes.
Okay, so where's the budget going with that, gentlemen? Where's the budget there? The Board of Selectmen instructions to the Planning Board for new developments, and Joe Coronati was just in here earlier this evening. We, with the volume of construction that we will be undertaking in this community, we are going to drown in waste. Planning Board has asked. They asked last year. Last year's board did not have the courage to get together to give specific direction. But we are the only ones who can do that, and the Planning Board is entitled to guidance. They need guidance as they're seeing these proposals come before them, and we need to tell the Planning Board, and I'm prepared to so move, if the Chairman will kindly put it on next week's agenda, that we direct the Planning Board that this Board of Selectmen is stating that we will no longer agree to accept any waste or a recycling collection from new developments. We cannot continue to do this. Also, the rolling stock review, we have got to sit down. Fred mentioned that he believes we can pull 5 of the 18 pickup trucks in the Public Works Department. We've got to start reducing the number of vehicles in Public Works, and we need to start providing them with vehicles that really will do the job, including cutting out plowing with pickup trucks and get bigger, heavier vehicles out there for the men to go plowing the roads. It's ridiculous to be plowing roads in the town of Hampton with pickup trucks. In addition, we need to start talking about, for the 2015 budget, the pole barns. That the vehicles are sitting out there rotting. next to the salt water, of all places. They're not even snuggled in somewhere on the west side of town. We've got vehicles rusting and rotting. A, we have no washdown facility on site. And B, there's no place to shelter the vehicles, and they're sitting out there rotting and rusting. And I hope you have a tour of the public works facilities shortly so you can take a close look firsthand at that.
I've been down there.
Have you looked at all the...
I haven't looked at everything, but I've been...
Little happily rusting vehicles? We have a huge, huge investment in the vehicles in this community, particularly in the Public Works Department. And we are neglecting those vehicles, and we're paying for it. And the washdown shed, once again, and it's going to be a hard warrant to put together next year, but we've got to be able to wash down particularly the sewer and drain vehicles. You have your sewer clogged in the middle of the winter? You know what kind of a winter we're emerging from. You have a clog in your sewer line and the sewer and drain truck can't come out to you because the water's all frozen in it? We have huge issues here that have to be addressed. And I'm hoping we can see the Public Works Director sooner rather than later to go over this with him. And I think we need to go over every piece of rolling stock. Fred, estimated delivery on the new sweeper?
Don't have it yet.
Don't have it yet? And we don't have anything yet on the other two pieces, the loader and nothing yet? Okay.
They haven't been brought to the board yet.
Right. Okay. And there are huge, huge issues facing us. So if you're happy taking every other week off this summer, fine. And let all that hang over you and let it hold over for another year and another year, but that's dreadfully irresponsible. We have got to take this in hand, particularly public works, public works, public works. And I have other stuff here.
Please continue.
Okay, sewer buy-in charge. Once again, tied in with the building. 36 residential condos and 6 to 8 businesses in the A block. And all I see when I sat on the planning board, and I still see it now, is toilets, sinks, showers, washing machines, whatever use is going on in the commercial businesses, and all of that's going into the wastewater treatment plant that we have been paying on for years. I've been here 50 years contributing to the upkeep of that plant. And the manager was kind enough to come in with me to the planning board in 2012 to plead for them to assess the impact fee for Muni, and they wouldn't do it, and they haven't done it, and I doubt that they ever will do it. But Fred's estimate was what, Fred, if we need to replace the treatment plant? $60 to $1 million? You want to put that on the taxpayers? I see no reason why we can't implement. I passed the information out to all of you on what Dover's doing. What's the matter with us? Now, we have authority from the public. You talk about the vote. Public voted to give us the authority under 149I. Fred was saying something last week about, oh, it's going to take time. We haven't got time. And I asked if we can do an interim proposal under 149I as a board to assess best guess fee. We could even possibly use Dover's figure and say, this is temporary. We're going to assess it as you get your building permit. But then we'll adjust. Once we get the final figures from whatever engineering firm, then we'll adjust and we'll either give you a refund or we'll bill you for a little more. But we are going to let these developments slip through, and that's a terrible disservice to the public unless we can get off and out of our seats and get some of this work done. There's a huge amount of work, and a lot of it is left over from kicking the can down the road by prior boards. We have got to get that sewer buy-in charge on tap. Now, Public Works Director, potholes and maintenance, highway crews, the pole barns and the rolling stock, I want to see us amend the recycling and solid waste ordinance and have this in the back of our minds for an amendment to that ordinance to deny the state of New Hampshire any ability to dispose of waste on Hampton property. We are handling all that waste. We're clogging up our transfer station. It's time, and in line with what Phil has been saying about it being left on the short end of the stick as far as the state is concerned. The state has land.
They have money, God knows, because we're not getting it, and they need to take the bull by the horns and get rid of their own waste. And yes, I will continue to talk about waste. Church Street parking lot, Fred, how soon is the bathroom going to be in there?
I haven't talked to the director. I haven't talked to the director. He's got to schedule that with Aquarian. He's okay.
But we're on track.
Sewer division.
Okay.
I want to talk about that. I called the labor board today myself to ask about the assertions that there must be bathrooms. And when I first called, I talked to one of the safety inspectors, not safety inspectors, but the labor inspector. And she didn't even really know how to answer the question. And then they asked that I would talk, they would have a field inspector call me back, which they did. I believe it was Mrs. Schofield. And so I asked her, and I didn't mention that I was calling from Hampton or that I was a selectman or anything like that. And at first, how I asked, I led her to believe that it was for a she informed me that their rules are different if you're a private parking lot or if you are a state or town parking lot. And the rules are, it's regulated if you're a private parking lot by OSHA, not the labor board. If you are, and then as I realized that I had led her to believe that it was private, so I said, well, what if it is a municipal parking lot? Basically, what she told me is they kind of leave it up to the town to decide. I don't think there is a steadfast law that says there needs to be a bathroom.
Well, you need to read 673A, Richard.
I called the lady. This is what she told me.
I called them, too.
And so they pretty much leave it up to whatever's been done. Now, in the 9 years that I was here before, I never once heard one complaint about anyone. I do know now that they are whenever they do get regular breaks, and Diana is part of her management style, how they do it, and there has been no problems. Diana does not want a porta potty under any circumstance. And where there hasn't been any problems, and where she doesn't want a porta potty, I would think that if there was a problem, a porta potty would be welcomed. So I really think that this is something that needs to be discussed by this board, especially where nothing's been done about it so far. And I'm anxious to talk with Mr. Noyes about that also.
Thank you.
He's going to be busy.
And just to continue, Selectman Woolsey, you had requested to be on the agenda. We listened to, mm-hmm. to your... it was 15 minutes.
I know that.
And that's fine. You're a select person. And do you have any other commentary tonight?
I have a couple of quick things. Okay. I think the finance director is due to leave us by retiring next month. We need to sit down with the finance director. There is an advertisement for a replacement director. We need to understand potential salary. We need to understand final settlement costs with Mr. Schwarzer. We need to have an advertisement out for a town planner. We need to sit down and get guidance, I think fiscal guidance, on these new positions. And where is the money coming from? Once again, default budget. We need to know exactly what we're facing with the replacement positions. And I think we could use the benefit of Mr. Schwarzer's guidance before he leaves. The rest is the trust funds, which Arthur referenced tonight, and I'm going to leave that for the moment. I think we have more than enough on our plate. And I'm going to say one final thing. First of all, in addition to the bathroom at the Church Street parking lot, we need to have first aid kits in every shed in the parking lots as well, and I know Diana ordered some last fall. So I'm sure they will be in there.
Wonderful. Thank you, ma'am. Anything else?
Oh, I'm capable of making lists, but for the moment I'll spare you.
But
once again,
yes, ma'am.
There is too much work on our plate to sit here saying we don't want to meet in the summer.
Thank you. Selectman Griffin.
Okay. I'm looking forward to seeing Mr. Noyes also. Another part, now I'm not really quite sure about this, but I think it is possible from talking to the lady at the Labor Board. I think that part of the reason why they make these considerations for state or town or municipal is that I'm not so sure if there is a bathroom there, it's not supposed to be open to the public besides.
It's not supposed to be open to the public.
Well, from what she told me, there isn't. They don't make these issues about the employees. She did say something when I asked her about the employees, about being open to the public also. So I didn't even bother going into that whatever. I just didn't bother to go further to ask. But I thought that if this does come down to this, then maybe we should invite someone from the Labor Board here to talk with us.
Thank you, sir. And did you have any other comments under Roman 10, number 5?
No.
Thank you. Mr. Bridle.
Mr. Welsh.
Sir.
Do the other two sheds have bathrooms in them?
Yes, they do.
They do. I know this has been talked about since last year.
Mm-hmm.
I think we should actually do something about it and get it done.
Thank you.
Do we have the capabilities to put it in that shed that's there now on the Church Street lot?
Technically, yes.
Technically.
It's been given to Keith to make sure that he can install and the unit within the existing shed.
Mm-hmm.
So he has it on his docket because the board voted to put it there.
Do we have the funding capable of doing that? I know the water
it's
company.
It's not really going to cost us anything.
Then I'll make a motion that we continue with that bathroom and have it put in that shed. We've been asked by the rec director to have that, and I think it's time that we made a decision and get it put in.
I'm seconding.
Actually, it's already made.
Yes.
So then
it's already in process. But I'll second Rusty.
Well, may I just grab the floor as your chair and a member that serves you folks, Mr. Welch. Please give us the status of what the board voted on, if you can, and are prepared to do so tonight about this laboratory.
The prior board voted to instruct the Public Works Department mm-hmm. to install a laboratory on that property, subject to approval by the church. The church has approved it.
Yes.
And they have signed a lease extending the lease for the town
mm-hmm.
at a slight increased cost, which will go up until we get to a certain figure a number of years from now. So we have direction from the board. It's been given to the Department of Public Works, and they're going to do that this spring.
Now,
an aquarium.
And let me just kind of, because it's all this discussion may be moot, it would seem to me that the motion would be to the contrary if a board member had one, because this is already moving forward.
It's
so we don't need to.
We don't need to make a motion.
Okay.
An aquarium
so would you
is
like
performing
to rescind
the work,
your motion?
No charge.
I'll rescind it. If it's already been made and it's in the works, and then let's just
thank
get
you,
it done.
Sir. And now may I ask you on 10, number 5, any further comments under Roman 10, number 5?
Not at this time.
Okay. Mr. Waddell, please, sir.
He was making a list all the time I was talking.
Yeah, right in my head. That's where I always make them. You know, on a lot of things on the DPW and stuff, I think, you know, Keith's going to come in, he's going to talk to us, he's going to do it. But I think if we want to get these meetings to be productive and we want to keep moving ahead, it's not more meetings. It's let's stop beating dead horses, all right? The trash issue is a dead horse. It's been voted on. Let it go. Let's move on to the issues that need to be dealt with. We need to deal with the budget. You talked about that. Yes, we do. We need to deal with the fire inspector. Yes, we do. So let's not deal with something that's been
dealt with before.
It's gone. It's been voted on. It's dead. If you want to come up another time, fine. Let's deal with the big issues, and let's deal with them in an efficient manner. Let's have, when Keith comes in, give him the things, he can talk to us about it. But let's not just keep going on and on and on about something that's already been talked about. That's my only thought.
Thank you. Any other comments under old business, please?
We need the meetings scheduled. We need to have them on the agenda. And just as a point of information, Rusty, Aquarian will extend the water line at no charge.
Okay. Well,
that's going to be minimal.
It's already said it's going to be done, so it's going to be done.
Thank you. Moving on. Roman 11, new business. Number one, vote to approve and sign 6 union contracts. Mr. Welch, please.
I have them, sir. Up to you to vote to approve the contracts and to sign them.
Wonderful. Is there a motion?
I will so move, Mr. Second. Chairman.
Seconded. And do we need to list the individual union contracts, or?
I don't believe so, since there are only 6 unions and you're approving all of them.
Wonderful. There has been a motion by Selectman Woolsey, seconded by Mr. Bridle. All those in favor?
And these have already been approved by the public.
Thank you. Roman 12, consent agenda. The Board of Selectmen new schedule. Number 2, parade and public gathering licenses for Cycle the Seacoast. Number 3, thank you, Esquire. Entertainment licenses, Ron's Landing, World's Greatest Karaoke Bar, Savory Square Bistro. Number 4, use of town property, community picnic, Morelli's, incorrectly spelled, 100th anniversary. Number 5, raffle permit, Hampton Arts Network, 5714 and 10914. Number 6, Hampton Cemetery Deed, Gail O'Connor Munger. Selectman Griffin, can you take 7 through 12 on timing, please?
Their new elderly exemption, number 7, the same for number 8. Number 9 is a new disabled exemption. Number 10 is a requalifying elderly exemption, as is number 11. And number 12 is a requalifying veterans tax credit.
Thank you, sir. Is there a motion?
We'll make the motion.
I would like to exempt number 1 and have that a separate motion. That's the Board of Selectmen's schedule.
Okay, the board has voted for that, and you were defeated in that for 4-1. May I please?
May I please?
And the board voted for this schedule, and the vote was 4-1. So I will not accept that motion.
But why is it included in the consent agenda?
May I please move forward?
I'll make that motion.
Motion. Is there a second to approve the agenda? Thank you. All those in favor?
Where am I? Right here?
Yeah, on the bottom.
Selectman Waddell, are you in favor?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Selectman Woolsey, please.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, that's unanimous. Thank you. Number Roman 13, entertainment licenses under review. 1, Wally's Pub, 144 Ashworth Avenue. Number 2, Millie's Tavern on L Street.
I'll make that motion.
No, you should see them next week. They're under review by the police department and fire department.
That's just for informational and a warning of the public, if you will. Number Roman 14, closing comments. Selectman Woolsey.
I'll spare you for the moment.
Thank you. Selectman Griffin. Selectman Bridle. Selectman Waddell. A motion.
There you go.
A motion to adjourn, perhaps?
I'll make it.
Second.
All those in favor?
At 9:34 p.m.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you very much.
Sure, I'll take those, Brett.